Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Young Castro, The Making of a Revolutionary by Jonathan M. Hansen. Narrated by Timothy Andrés Pabon. History is a product of so many different interpretations and points of view that it's hard to be sure that true history exists. Years from now, if historians describe what happened in Cuba today, what will they say? How close will they get to the facts? What will they get wrong? Fidel Castro, 1992. Preface. Tengo material abundante para el estudio de los grandes movimientos políticos contemporáneos, socialismo, fascismo, y nazismo. Fidel Castro wrote Nati Revuelta in April 1954. Pero no tengo nada del New Deal de Roosevelt. I have plenty of material about the great political movements, socialism, fascism, and Nazism, but nothing about Roosevelt's New Deal. At the same time, Castro was serving the ninth month of a 26-year sentence for his leadership in an attack on the Moncada military barracks in Santiago de Cuba, and was looking to expand his library. Revuelta was a friend and fellow rebel. The two were in the early stage of an epistolary love affair. When Revuelta suggested a book about Roosevelt's foreign policy, Castro demurred. "What I really want to document," he explained, "is FDR's program of raising agricultural prices, promoting and preserving soil fertility, providing credit, forgiving debt, expanding internal and external markets, creating jobs, reducing working hours, lifting wages, assisting the unemployed, aging, and infirm, reorganizing industry, revising the tax code, regulating trusts, and reforming banking and monetary policy." In short, just about everything he himself wanted to do for Cuba. Castro's romance with Revuelta, which lasted just shy of 6 months, produced over 100 letters, only a handful of which have ever been published in radically abridged form. The available excerpts are tantalizing, revealing a prisoner wrestling with the future of Cuba while immersed in world history and literature and contemplating the meaning of life. Sensing that the letters could help me round out the caricature of Castro that passes for authoritative biography, I reached out to Revuelta in 2014 in much the same way that Castro himself had done a half century earlier. I had material abundante, consistent with existing stereotypes, I explained. Could she help me with evidence to illuminate the real man? Cubans are wary of U.S. writers revisiting the life of a figure they continue to admire, despite his own and the revolution's deficiencies. When a friend reported that Revuelta was willing to meet me, I was hopeful, if somewhat shy of optimistic. Gazing out at me from her shaded entryway as I stood in the blazing sunshine atop the steep front stairway of her home in the new Vedado neighborhood of Havana, Revuelta had the caution of an aging beauty, accustomed to sizing up approaching predators. "Bienvenido," came a low, raspy voice from out of the shadows. I extended my hand, which she graciously accepted, her cold, bony clasp reminding me of my late grandmother. Before my eyes could adjust, she led me on to a sun-dappled terrace, its green wicker chairs surrounded by tropical plants, palm, ficus, philodendron, bird of paradise. A small electric fan whirred futilely nearby, the faint tropical aroma overwhelmed by a cigarette smoldering in a nearby ashtray full to the brim. A glass coffee table was strewn with the day's newspaper, various magazines and books, along with a few articles and photographs that seemed to have been cobbled together for me. The letters were nowhere to be seen. Clad in a sleeveless flower print dress and sandals, the once voluptuous, now reed-like Revuelta seemed to float above the tile floor. "Siéntate," she said, before continuing in perfect English. "So you're writing a book about young Fidel." Sitting down herself, Revuelta erupted in a violent cough, her frail body racked to the bone. Waving away my look of concern, she ordered an assistant to bring us coffee. Yes, I said, as she looked at me through emerald eyes with a skeptical smile and characteristic cock of her head. I want to get this story right, and I'm told you can help me. Several months and a few leisurely visits later, I heard that Revuelta was ready to share her letters with me, only to learn upon arriving at her home one afternoon that she had changed her mind. No hay problema, Nati, I said, pulling out a letter Castro had written his father from Bogota. Let me show you something I just discovered in the archives. The letter, which few have ever seen, brims with youthful innocence and detailed descriptions of the physical landscape and political economy of Panama, Venezuela, and Colombia. These voyages impart great wisdom and experience at the same time that they open up great horizons and perspectives, Castro told his father. Revuelta read on silently, her eyes welling with tears. That's so Fidel, she murmured. That's so Fidel. She then stood up, entered her library, and returned with a thick stack of paper, which she plopped down on my lap, punctuating the moment with a single unceremonious word. Here. This book is not a defense of Fidel Castro. My aim is to recreate his life as he actually lived it, moving forward, without the benefit of hindsight. With this in mind, I ask a favor of the listener. Suspend for a moment the image you have of a bearded revolutionary clad in green fatigues, communist at conception, anti-American in utero, bilious at birth, and hearken instead to a saga that begins in a small stone farmhouse in northwest Spain at the end of the 19th century. The reward for doing so may not be a more likable Castro, but one whose aspirations, accomplishments, and failures make sense in light of the political and economic conditions that inspired and constrained them. Listeners willing to take this leap will learn a few things that may surprise them. Castro did not commit himself or Cuba to communism until after the triumph of the revolution in January 1959. He did so ultimately not as an end in itself, but as a means to the end of securing the revolution from domestic and foreign opposition, including the United States government. This argument holds both for Castro's embrace of the Cuban Communist Party in 1959 and for his alliance with the Soviet Union in the aftermath of the Bay of Pigs invasion. Had Castro been more successful in building a disciplined political party to match his guerrilla army before he came to power, his turn to the PSP, which had never demonstrated much interest in him or his armed struggle, would not have been necessary. Castro grew up a liberal nationalist, inspired by the unrequited dream of Cuba Libre, a Cuba free and independent of foreign rule and dedicated to the well-being of all its people. This program comprised both constitutionalism and civil rights, along with a set of social entitlements that included access to education, healthcare, employment, and a decent standard of living, common in Cuban cities, but harder to find in rural areas. In his late 20s, a maturing Castro tied Cuba's struggle for sovereignty and independence to a liberal tradition that encompassed the English Civil War and the American, French, Haitian, and Latin American revolutions, at the same time that he insisted that Cuba had a unique contribution to make to social and political science. Citing both Montesquieu and Simón Bolívar, he imagined Cuba charting a third way, at once democratic and socialistic. Castro's rise is incomprehensible without an understanding of Cuban history and the history of U.S.-Cuban relations, which he knew like the back of his hand. The dream of national sovereignty and self-determination was hardly unique to Cuba, but Cuba waited an especially long time for independence. When Cubans thought they had it in their grasp in 1898, the United States snatched it away, inaugurating 6 decades of political and economic subservience that haunts Cuba to this day. Throw in the constraints of the Cold War, and the fate of the Cuban Revolution seems overdetermined. Despite arguments to the contrary, the U.S. government was never prepared to recognize the revolution on Castro's original terms, making his alliance with the Soviet Union all but inevitable. Castro's liberal nationalist agenda was neither original nor inherently revolutionary. Cuban politicians had been espousing this platform since the founding of the Cuban Republic in 1902, only to become distracted upon taking office by the opportunity for financial gain. By contrast, Castro meant it when he said it, making him not only radical, but dangerous to establishment politicians left, right, and center, as well as to the outside banks and corporations, many of them North American, which pulled the strings. Call it a fixation, call it an obsession, call it what you will. Castro experienced Cuba's subservience to the United States like a scarlet S tattooed on his chest, resolving at a remarkably young age to once and for all win Cuba's liberty, even at the cost of liberty itself. Castro regarded the struggle for Cuba Libre as part of a larger anti-colonial project that encompassed not just the rest of Latin America, but much of Africa and Asia besides. To critics, Castro's internationalism appeared at once dangerous and grandiose. U.S. officials accused Castro of meddling in other countries' affairs, as if the United States alone was authorized to do so. To Castro, as to Guatemala's Jacobo Arbenz, Egypt's Gamal Abdel Nasser, Vietnam's Ho Chi Minh, and countless other revolutionaries fighting to rid their nations of colonialism, it simply made sense to combine forces. There was strength in numbers. Again, this idea was hardly new at the time. Simón Bolívar and José Martí had seen it much the same way a century before. Castro was not motivated originally by money or power. He grew up on a plantation in eastern Cuba owned by his parents, which stretched 42 square miles across some of Cuba's most valuable farmland. By the time he was old enough to choose a vocation, his parents' enterprise included not only sugarcane production, but lumber, cattle, and mining operations besides. If it was money or influence he was after, he did not have to take on a U.S.-backed military dictatorship to get it. As a newly minted lawyer in 1950, he was practically granted the keys to his parents' kingdom, only to look the other way. He simply would not be domesticated. He spent much of his mid-20s making common cause with the men and women who first put their lives on the line for independence from Imperial Spain. Their work remained unfinished a century later, and Castro worried that they were being forgotten. Much of his quixotic, some would say reckless behavior, represents his attempt to reacquaint Cubans with this revolutionary tradition. Castro's solicitation for Cuban peasants and workers was deep-seated and sincere. Growing up on his parents' plantation, Castro's playmates were invariably the children of peasants and farm laborers. Returning home on school holidays, he easily fell back in among them, cherishing the local ways even as he became increasingly worldly. Crucially, his own parents were born and raised in peasant households, his father amid crushing hardship, a fact which no amount of new wealth could disguise. Observers later remarked that Castro always seemed at ease when engaging peasants and workers. This comfort was literally in his blood. As a young boy joining his father on his rounds at the cane fields, Castro witnessed more than just a conventional encounter between labor and management. These were also, at some level, exchanges between peers, his father's economic mobility providing fodder for his own Pan-American dream. Castro grew up feeling like an outsider, not an outcast exactly, but an island, vulnerable and alone. Old schoolmates describe him as preoccupied at times, even detached. During the Great Depression and periodic price collapses that afflicted Cuba's sugar economy, the Castro children never remember going hungry. This could not be said of their neighbors, and Castro recalled often scraping together leftovers to share with friends. At boarding school in Santiago de Cuba and Havana, he was greeted as a hick. Later at the university, he described feeling isolated and exposed. Later still, he grew frustrated by Cubans' passivity in the face of a stultifying status quo, as if he were the lone voice in the wilderness calling the people to a higher end. He wasn't, of course, but he saw it that way, a fact that would become increasingly important as he began to attract followers and build a movement whose outcome would depend on his ability to work productively with others. Castro believed his record of sacrifice and single-minded dedication to the cause of Cuba Libre gave him and him alone the legitimacy to lead the revolutionary struggle and eventually the revolutionary government. This too is debatable, as there were many capable opposition leaders pushed aside by fate, accident, or by Castro himself. The last man standing is not necessarily the most deserving or most qualified. Still, Castro could be excused for thinking the revolution would not have been waged, much less won, but for him. His extravagant claim to be the embodiment of the revolution stems partly from the unlikelihood of his family's rise from rags to riches and of his surviving innumerable mishaps and setbacks, including sepsis at age 7, gang warfare at the university, a foiled invasion of the Dominican Republic, revolutionary upheaval in Colombia, and the Moncada barracks attack, just to name a few. The odds against Castro surviving to win and lead the revolution appear preposterous in retrospect. Once captured after Moncada, he should never have been brought in alive. Once jailed, the key to his cell should have been thrown away. Once freed, he should have been eliminated while in exile. Once bound for home with 82 men aboard a boat built for 8, including crew, he should never have survived a botched landing. Once ashore, he should never have eluded the government ambush that reduced the 82 men to 14. Once in the mountains, he should never have outfought Batista's military. Once victorious, he should never have outlasted innumerable U.S.-backed plans, first to deny him victory, then to overthrow his government, finally to assassinate him. Considering all the pawns in the Cold War who have come and gone over the years, he should never have outlived 9 U.S. presidents, while vexing a 10th, if only posthumously. Cats have 9 lives. Castro had 9 times 9. But we make our own luck, the saying goes, and Castro was a maestro. He believed he was chosen. Given this litany, it's hard to argue with him. This does not justify many of his actions or excuse his seizing power for half a century, but it helps explain them. Only I could have done this. Only I can see this through. Finally, as with so many world historical figures, Castro's strengths were the source of his greatest weaknesses. He was at once brilliant and arrogant, charismatic and overbearing, courageous and reckless, pragmatic and quixotic. He had a killer instinct, as those in his line of work always do. Capable of real affection, he possessed a coldness at the nether reaches of the Kelvin scale. In the end, he was able to love one thing and one thing only. Not his first wife, Mirta, not his son, Fidelito, not even himself. He loved the revolution. At the height of his powers, he was said to have been able to tolerate one person on a day-to-day basis, Celia Sanchez, not a lover exactly, but someone whose commitment to the revolution rivaled his own. In waging and defending the revolution, he could be simultaneously stoical and self-pitying, forgiving and vengeful, solicitous and autocratic. Not all of these characteristics are easy to explain. Many are hard to defend. This book attempts to account for as many of them as possible. Chapter 1. Like Father. Like the fieldstone farmhouses of Láncara, Galicia, the boy born the night of December 5, 1875, to Manuel Castro Núñez and Antonia Argis Fernández, was made to last. Castro, from the Galician castrexa, Latin castrum, means castle or fort. Ángel Castro Argis, Fidel Castro's father, had the build and bearing of the granite lintel that framed the doorway of his parents' low-slung home. First and last surviving photographs reveal a figure as unyielding as inland Galicia itself, short, stout, chiseled, severe, with sagging eyelids and furrowed brow, a walled city, a Castro of one. Angel was the couple's second child, the first to make it through a night. A survivor by sunrise of his natal day, Angel embodied his parents' faith, not that things would be good in Langara exactly, but that things could be better. All infants did not die in childbirth. All livestock did not succumb to wolves. The rain would cease, the cold would ease. The restoration of King Alfonso XII would end the chaos unleashed by 22 months of republican government. For 11 years, the family's fortune held. Then the latest child went the way of the first, this time taking her mother Antonia along with her. The couple had lost its hedge with fate, and the families quickly disintegrated. Two surviving daughters were sent to live with a nearby aunt. The father remarried the next year. The boy, just 12, quit his sad and broken home in search of something better. He did not wander far at first, taking up with two sausage-making uncles in the nearby village of Armea, a patchwork of pastures, fields, and woods from Lankara, on the south bank of the Neira River. 3 years later, having tired of sausage-making, Angel left home again, this time for Madrid, the nation's capital, 470 kilometers southeast of Lankara, where he called on a distant aunt. Descending Spain's Cordillera Central onto the outskirts of Madrid on day 10 or so of what would become a decades-long pilgrimage, Angel would have sensed the city long before arriving in it. By 1890, Madrid was enjoying the fruits of a commercial revolution two generations old that had swept south and west into the heart of the Iberian Peninsula, from the port cities of Barcelona and Bilbao, and which introduced new industries and markets, new legal and political institutions, new social and civil allegiances. The revolution was surely palpable in the vibrant colors and commotion, the unfamiliar smells and tastes which greeted Angel as he approached the city. It was present, too, in the curious confidence and carelessness of the young boys and girls he met along the way, who must have regarded the country bumpkin with bemusement. This new world would prove as cruel as it was exhilarating. But its downsides would have been easy to miss as Angel crossed the Puente Segovia and disappeared into the heart of the old city. Any one of Madrid's great public squares could absorb more visitors than populated all the little villages along the Neira. The Plaza Mayor, its stalls bursting with luxuries, the Puerta del Sol with its opulent townhouses, the spanking new Jardines del Buen Retiro, where the city elite frolicked, boated, basked, and bowled, made Madrid seem less a distant metropolis in Angel's eyes than a foreign country with its own moral and political economy. Everything the boy had learned from his parents about virtue and self-discipline toppled head over heels with the nimble acrobats, spoiled children, and brazen couples on the sumptuous lawns of Buen Retiro. With time, Angel would learn to manipulate the economic levers of the new liberal order, but there is no record of him ever succumbing to its hedonism. Years later, with a family of his own, Angel insisted that his children pursue higher education. The cost of his own illiteracy was everywhere apparent in Madrid, where he found himself shut out from the lucrative clerical and administrative jobs that characterized the new commercial economy. Unqualified for meaningful work, he was cut off from the pleasures that went with it. The elegant restaurants, the hypnotic music, the coded flirtation, the casual strolls, even the rough and tumble world of sport were the province of a class above, and no amount of backbreaking work in a butchery here or bakery there could win him elevation. For 4 years, Angel toiled in vain to amass the savings that might alter his fate. Relief came not in a lucky break, but in a note from home, when in 1894, with Spain on the verge of war in Cuba, the government issued a draft decree. Ordered to attend a lottery in the Galician town of Carracedo, Angel, now 18, retraced his steps across the city, behind him a beguiling but unforgiving capital, ahead a tedious ascent up the Cordillera Central toward a future no more promising than when he first departed Lankara. Unable to read or write, Angel made his mark on the world with his hands and feet. His mother's death launched him on an extended journey that took him to Madrid and back, to Cuba and back, then back to Cuba again, finally to Oriente province in far eastern Cuba, to stay, where despite long odds he managed to establish a toehold, and eventually, the financial footing that allowed him to settle down. The man who emerged from this pilgrimage was not a cultured, playful, adoring father or spouse, as we shall see, but he was a dogged worker, a reliable neighbor, and a generous benefactor, determined to provide his children the stability and education he lacked. As befits the surname Castro, Angel was resolutely self-assured, able to get along with others when necessary, but ready to go it alone, a characteristic he passed on to his famous son. To be drafted into Spain's army in 1894 was inauspicious, even for a luckless Lancaran. Decades of corruption and neglect had rendered the Spanish army less an effective fighting force than a gentleman's club, bloated at the top, rotting at the bottom, good for little more than keeping Spaniards themselves in line. A people's army, the saying goes, is dangerous to its neighbors. A professional army is dangerous to its own people. By the time Angel was summoned to Carracedo, Spain's army had long since ceased to provide the rank and file with decent housing, diet, sanitation, medical care, even adequate training. These are requisites not only of an effective fighting force, but of life itself. Deprived of these, Spanish soldiers expired in astonishing numbers. 10% in their first year of service, 25% over the next 4 years, bringing the toll to nearly 4 deaths for every 10 soldiers over a 5-year enlistment, and this not in war, but in peacetime, and on the Iberian Peninsula itself. To make matters worse, the nation's draft laws encouraged wealthy citizens to buy their way out of military service. This created a caste system in which regular enlistees were treated as common criminals, deployed as strikebreakers, and forced to work the fields. The Spanish public was powerless to do much about the corruption and abuse. New laws forbade criticism of the army and restricted freedom of the press. Individuals who defied the laws were made to answer in military courts. Opponents of the regime, like Carlists, arch-conservatives, and Republicans, leftists, were posted to remote and undesirable settings. The result was a rank and file populated by the most desperate and defenseless Spaniards, in short, by the likes of Angel Castro. Angel's draft number was not called at Carracedo. A year later, he got the opportunity to leave home again, when for the third time in a generation, Cuban separatists led by an exiled nationalist named José Martí declared independence from Spain on February 24, 1895. Desperate to attract recruits to fight in a climate Spaniards had learned to loathe, the government offered stipends payable at the stroke of a pen. Angel promptly signed on, concluding that if things might not be better in Cuba, they could hardly be worse. By the time Manuel Castro delivered up his eldest son to the Spanish army at the port of A Coruña in August 1895, the Cuban War of Independence was 6 months old. A conflict that had elicited only the most casual shrug from the Spanish government initially had become a source of consternation across the land. For decades, senior army officers had refused postings to the Antilles, so notorious were the islands for heat, humidity, and tropical disease. In the latest flare-up, their intransigence led to the hasty promotion of reserve officers and ordinary enlistees with no experience in command of men. Combined with pre-existing problems, the inexperience proved immediately calamitous, and word reached home of skyrocketing fatalities in Cuba just as Angel's ship set sail. The public disquiet about these developments was palpable in the grim countenances of locals who lined the lanes to the nation's seaports for one last glimpse of the flower of Spain. Mothers and sons, sisters and brothers, clung to one another in scenes of desolation. When Spanish parents said goodbye to a beloved son drafted into the army, one historian has observed, they really meant it. Angel departed A Coruña on August 24, 1895, arriving in Cienfuegos on September 8th, after 16 topsy-turvy days at sea. He was posted to Remedios in central Cuba, just northeast of Santa Clara, headquarters of Spanish forces in a region identified as Cuba's Rubicon. Should the Cuban guerrillas penetrate west of there, Spanish officials believed, there would be no stopping an advance on the capital, Havana. Very little is known about Angel's day-to-day experience with the Regimiento Isabel II, but there is a good chance he never fired a shot. A disciplined guerrilla force is notoriously difficult to engage, and the Cuban general, Máximo Gómez, marshaled his resources shrewdly. Outnumbered by more than 5-1, the insurgents avoided face-to-face combat, striking from cover and undercover of darkness, while relying on local knowledge to dodge their adversary at lightning speed. Spain's strategy played into insurgent hands. Abandoning the countryside to the enemy, Spanish forces busied themselves protecting property, cities, and towns, as well as the trochas, trenches, that carved the island into thirds. Meanwhile, Spanish officers hired out troops on private terms to guard the great plantations, just as they had done back home in peacetime. The strategy made Spain's soldiers sitting ducks, easy to pick off as they stood rooted to their garrisons, easier to evade as the rebels knew their every whereabouts. It all made for a very curious kind of war. "The countryside is ours," a rebel leader wrote home in August 1895. "There is hardly any fighting in this revolution. It has been 2 months since I have had serious battles." A month later, little had changed. "We have crossed all the Camagüey without firing a shot." An onslaught of tropical disease exacerbated Spain's misguided strategy. By the time the war ended in summer 1898, Spain had dispatched nearly 200,000 men to Cuba, a record in colonial warfare at that time. Spain's losses throughout the war are conservatively estimated at 42,000 killed. Of these, some 4,000 died in combat, the remaining 93% from disease. At any one time during the war, more than half Spain's soldiers were incapacitated due to illness. Midway into the four-year war, illnesses climbed above 230,000 for 2 years in a row. Virtually every Spanish soldier became sick at least once during the war. Angel joined this wretched host just as the insurrection gained strength. Accompanying him were 40,000 new recruits, many of them teenagers far younger than he. Novices were given no training, granted no period of acclimatization. It took a little over 8 months for mosquitoes, gnats, fleas, flies, lice, and poor sanitation to break down Angel's natural defenses, remarkable in a theater that saw one in two soldiers incapacitated in their first 2 months in Cuba. In June 1896, Angel was hospitalized for the first time with fever, chills, and delirium. The following December, he was admitted for 11 days with stiff and swollen joints. Out of the hospital, soldiers were hardly safe, as the garrisons to which they returned resembled hospital wards, only without the medical staff. Once sick, Angel could not dodge the microbial bombardment. In 1897, he was hospitalized 7 different times for typhus, rheumatism, ulcers, malaria, diarrhea, lesions, and general fatigue. One hospital stay lasted an entire month. The end of the war brought no relief. Angel returned to hospital on the eve of the armistice in July 1898, then again early the next year while awaiting transportation home. Together with Spain's garrison strategy, the rampaging disease leveled the playing field. The few times Spain sallied forth to engage the foe directly, it did so with more or less equal numbers, and the results were catastrophic. At the aptly named Battle of Maltiempo in December 1895, a Spanish regiment stumbled headfirst into a trap set by the guerrillas. In the ensuing melee, 65 Spaniards were hacked to death by machete, 40 grievously wounded. The role of the machete at Maltiempo inspired the legend that the guerrillas were amateurs who fought this war by hand. In fact, They were battle-tested marksmen who used the machete as their principal weapon as a last resort. One need not have survived mal tiempo to suffer its effect on Spanish morale, as fear of the machete won permanent lodging in the minds of greenhorns like Ángel. Still, the significance of the battle lies elsewhere, namely in the lesson it suggests that on a level battlefield, the advantage goes to the side that knows what it is fighting for. The rebel success in taking the battle to the heart of Cuba brought turnover atop the Spanish command. In February 1896, Valeriano Weyler replaced Arsenio Martinez Campos as Captain General of Cuba. Weyler is said to have greeted his last appointment with the remark that war should be answered with war. Cubans interpreted Weyler's appointment as prophecy of mayhem. Weyler did not disappoint, corralling peasants into concentration camps, destroying the homes and fields they left behind. Weyler's destruction of the rebels' food supply cleared western Cuba of insurgents, but did nothing to end the insurrection. Less than a year after his arrival, the number of rebel troops in the country had swollen from a mere 3,000 at the start of the conflict into the tens of thousands. By summer 1897, the war reached a stalemate not so different from the one that Weyler inherited, with Spaniards protecting the cities and insurgents ruling the countryside. As Weyler waged war on unarmed peasants, and as Ángel fought off infection, forces stirred in the Goliath to the north that would shape Cuba to the present day. The conflict in Cuba had not gone unnoticed in Washington, D.C., where for over a century, U.S. officials had kept a jealous eye on Cuba, which they regarded as the heart and filter of Atlantic commerce, hence essential to the welfare of the young republic. Over the course of the 19th century, U.S. merchants, slaveholders, and diplomats talked endlessly about buying or seizing Cuba from Spain. Only the perfect opportunity eluded them. Most Americans were content to leave Cuba in Spain's hands, so long as it did not threaten U.S. interests or invite British or French intervention. Weyler's brutality and the destruction of private property during the war refocused Americans' attention, with some calling on the government to intervene on the side of the Cuban independence, others for outright annexation. If the United States intended to intervene in the conflict, it would have to hurry. By late 1897, the war favored the insurgents, who began to target the cities just as Spanish troops began to lay down their arms. Through late 1897, talk of U.S. intervention in Cuba remained hypothetical. On New Year's Eve, a correspondent of the New York Herald visited General Gomez in his camp to see whether he still opposed U.S. intervention. "Not necessarily," Gomez replied, "so long as intervention did not mean annexation." With this distinction, Gomez struck preemptively at U.S. officials, who insisted that Cubans were incapable of self-government. How could anyone be sure just what Cubans were capable of, Gomez wondered, before they had been given the opportunity to prove themselves? Cuba's only objective was independence. "We have among us young men who have sacrificed everything to this sacred cause," he said. "Men who had but one goal in life, and this is to see the flag of Cuba supreme over Cape Maicí to San Antonio." Worried lest Cuba be robbed of any share in the honor of the expulsion of the Spaniards, Gomez was confident that the people of the United States will never balk us in this, our hour of victory. An insult and an explosion catapulted the United States into the Cuban conflict early the following year before Gomez or anybody else anticipated. On February 11th, 1898, the pro-intervention New York Journal greeted readers with a letter by a Spanish official describing U.S. President William McKinley as a weak and popularity-seeking hack politician. Though few Americans regarded these remarks as the worst insult in U.S. history, as the Journal declared, the slur brought cries for U.S. intervention to a fever pitch. The explosion of the battleship Maine in Havana Harbor 4 days later sealed the debate. A nation hungry for adventure needed no judicious weighing of the facts to discern the source of the Maine's destruction. The Maine was sunk by an act of dirty treachery, Theodore Roosevelt, Assistant Secretary of the Navy, concluded the following day. The New York Journal blamed an enemy secret infernal machine. On April 11th, President McKinley petitioned the United States Congress for authorization to intervene in Cuba. On April 19th, Congress passed a war resolution, which the president signed the next day. On April 21st, the president ordered a naval blockade of Cuba. On April 25th, the United States declared war on Spain. The most significant aspect of these preliminaries went virtually unnoticed. Attached to the war resolution was a legislative rider introduced by Republican Senator Henry M. Teller, known as the Teller Amendment, which, in one sentence, seemed to repudiate a century of U.S. policy toward Cuba. Clause 1 of the resolution asserted Cuba's independence. Clause 2 demanded Spain's withdrawal from Cuba. Clause 3 authorized the president to use the military to effect these ends. Then came the kicker. The United States hereby disclaims any disposition or intention to exercise sovereignty, jurisdiction, or control over said island, except for the pacification thereof, and asserts its determination, when that is accomplished, to leave the government and control of the island to its people. Historians disagree about how to account for the Teller Amendment. Its passage followed the withdrawal of a more radical resolution granting immediate recognition to the revolutionary government, suggesting that a bargain had been struck. Senator Teller, hailed from Colorado, home to a lucrative sugar beet industry, reeling from new European competition. The introduction of Cuban sugar into the U.S. sugar market duty-free could potentially ruin U.S. beet growers. And then there was the $1 million in cash that Tomás Estrada Palma, exiled leader of the Cuban Revolutionary Party in New York, handed to Samuel Janney, a Cuban lobbyist in Washington, to distribute among U.S. congressmen. Finally, there was widespread and sincere support for Cuba Libre among the American people and some elected officials. Whatever the explanation, there could be no doubting the amendment's effect. For the first time in U.S. history, American officials had elevated the cause of Cuban independence above American interests on the island. Americans were heading down to Cuba to help remove the Spanish. With that mission accomplished, they would leave Cuba in the hands of its people. U.S. Marines came ashore at Guantanamo Bay on June 10, 1895, quickly converting the bay into a coaling facility and staging ground for an advance on Santiago de Cuba 30 miles up the coast. In early July, U.S. forces launched a series of attacks on Spanish garrisons protecting Santiago, which included the Rough Riders' celebrated charge up San Juan Hill. In mid-July, Santiago capitulated to the United States, more or less bringing the Cuban conflict to a close. U.S. accounts of the victory ignored two salient aspects of the battle. First, how valiantly depleted Spanish forces rallied to meet the American attack. Second, how readily U.S. publicists transformed a brief intervention in a generation-old colonial conflict into a smashing American victory. With that victory came the right not only to rename the conflict the Spanish-American War, but to determine Cuba's future, notwithstanding the solemn promise of the Teller Amendment. U.S. military officials and journalists wasted no time making the case for annexation. Discussions centered on the question of Cubans' capacity for self-government, with U.S. officials ultimately deciding that Cuba could not be left to its own devices. A solution would have to be found for Teller. Ángel Castro remained posted in central Cuba through the end of hostilities in mid-July. The armistice might have made things worse for Spanish soldiers, who could expect little sympathy from an adversary that Spain had exploited for centuries. In fact, it proved more punishing to the Cubans. Besides providing Spaniards food and medicine as the fighting came to an end, U.S. generals deployed Spanish troops throughout the country to maintain order, as if regarding the people they had come to liberate as more menacing than the enemy itself. On July 17, 1898, Spain surrendered Santiago, not to the Cubans who had been waging this war for 30 years, but to the Americans who had arrived weeks earlier. On what might have been a day of celebration among victorious allies, U.S. General William Shafter refused to let the Cubans partake in Spain's surrender. Cuban General Calixto Garcia had fully expected U.S. forces to commandeer Santiago, its garrisons and forts. He was eager to cooperate with Shafter to preserve order until the time came for the U.S. to fulfill its pledge to establish a free and independent Cuban government. What could explain this official snubbing? Rumor had it that the Cubans planned a massacre. "This was calumny," Garcia responded. "We are not savages ignoring the rules of civilized warfare. We are a poor, ragged army, as ragged and poor as was the army of your forefathers in their noble war of independence. But like the heroes of Saratoga and Yorktown, we respect our cause too deeply to disgrace it with barbarism and cowardice." Shafter's humiliation of his Cuban hosts was the first in a long series of indignities visited on Cuba in the aftermath of the Spanish-Cuban-American War, as the United States struggled to reconcile its pledge, as stated in the Teller Amendment, to leave the government and control of the island to its people, with the centuries-old conviction that Cuba was essential to U.S. prosperity. As Angel Castro awaited transport home in autumn 1898, the United States recapitulated Shafter's snubbing of Garcia on a grand scale. When American and Spanish officials descended on Paris in early October to work out the details of the transfer of Spanish sovereignty over Cuba and its other colonial possessions to the United States, not a single Cuban representative could be spotted in their midst. Like Shafter, the U.S. government simply assumed that Cuba had no role to play in negotiations about its future. Angel Castro said little or nothing in later years about the North Americans' behavior at the end of the war. His son would make this history a cornerstone of the Cuban Revolution. The war itself could not have been much crueler to Angel had it taken him to the grave. Dispiriting news from Lancara punctuated his recurring hospital visits. In November 1896, one of two surviving sisters died. The last would follow a few years later. The next year, he lost a beloved grandfather. The news from home dispelled illusions that things would be better if he could only make it out of Cuba alive. He eventually did so in January 1899, exchanging his hospital bed for a musty hammock aboard the steamship Ciudad de Cádiz, just as the U.S. occupation formally began. There was scant rejoicing in the floating hospitals that creaked home after the war. Their passengers, like the once formidable empire itself, in tatters. In a belated act of sympathy, the government handed the soldiers 20 pesetas each as they set foot on Spanish soil, enough to get by for a few months at most. No handout could rectify successive years of capital neglect. Journalists struggled for words to describe the human wreckage that tumbled down the gangways. "Like Christ coming down from the cross," one wrote, "and dotted the dusty roads that fanned out from Spain's seaports, the light gone from their eyes, the blood from their cheeks, their bodies resembling scarred meat." The shame of arriving home in ruin was magnified by the soldiers' knowledge that nobody had cared enough to increase the odds of their success. The first boats pulled into Spain's seaports in autumn 1898. In the midst of a self-serving debate over who was to blame for the Cuban debacle. To be fair, the war had not been kind on the home front. War can spur economic growth, but only where governments possess the legitimacy to put the nation on a war footing, decidedly not the case in late 19th century Spain. Amid the void of leadership and solidarity, the nation's economy ground to a halt. Capital froze up, contracts lapsed, factories shuttered their doors. Hunger stalked the land. Bad now, La Correspondencia Militar wondered. What will happen next winter, with competition from soldiers returning from Cuba and Puerto Rico? There is an old fountain in the town square in Lancara that brims with water all year round. as inland Galicia has no dry season to speak of. Framing the square, which opens to the main road, are three stone barns, one of them cloaked in chipping stucco. Into that square, one cold, clammy day in early February 1899, marched a solitary figure, thin, disheartened, ground down, a quick right down a narrow lane, first building on the left, and there stood Angel Castro, face to face with the heavy farmhouse door, guardian of his family's grief, for the second time in 4 years, with nothing but fresh scars and a meager government handout to show for it. A son's return from war in Cuba might have been greeted as auspicious, what with the odds against him and the time he spent in hospital. But the Castros of Láncara had long since lost their faith in auspices, just as Angel himself had long since lost his love for home. Stingy from the first, fate had tightened its grip inexorably in his absence. Another little sister gone, a grandfather too. Even the warmest greeting could not allay Angel's growing conviction that his future lay outside Spain. For several months he tried to make a go of it in Láncara. In contrast to many of his fellow veterans, he still had his wits about him, along with two stout arms and legs. Not liking his prospects, he resolved to cross the sea once more, committing his future to a country whose dream of independence he had only recently set out to crush. On December 3rd, 1899, Angel arrived in Cuba for the second time, disembarking at the port of Havana and clearing U.S. customs the next day. By this time, the U.S. military occupation neared the end of its first full year, with the occupying forces at work improving sanitation, wiping out disease, creating municipal government, erecting infrastructure, building schools, in short, providing a climate favorable to U.S. investment. Asked for his thoughts about a stable Cuba, military governor Leonard Wood, the man in charge of the U.S. occupying force, took the mercenary view. When money can be borrowed at a reasonable rate of interest, and when capital is willing to invest in the island, a condition of stability will be reached. The U.S. citizens of all stripes flocked to Cuba in the aftermath of the war, as if to a new frontier. Real estate, agriculture, mining, finance, engineering, construction, education, the professions, gambling, prostitution, you name it, all were overrun by opportunistic Americans arriving on the island often with extended families in tow. It is hard to exaggerate the scale of the migration. By 1905, some 13,000 Americans had purchased land in Cuba valued at $50 million. By 1919, 44,000 Americans had relocated there, prompting one Southern journal to remark, "Little by little, the whole island is passing into the hands of American citizens." And why not? U.S. newspapers and magazines depicted Cuba as a land of perpetual sunshine, flowing with milk and honey, a year-round country with no unproductive season. By contrast, Cubans found it difficult to square the talk of liberty and opportunity with the fact of U.S. domination. "There is so much natural anger and grief throughout the island," General Gomez noted in his diary in January 1899, "that the people haven't really been able to celebrate the triumph of the end of their former ruler's power." The end of the U.S. military occupation did not improve things from Cubans' perspective. Obligated by the Teller Amendment to uphold Cuban independence after the war, U.S. authorities came up with a legislative vehicle known as the Platt Amendment to render the new Cuban Republic a U.S. colony in all but name. Among other things, the Platt Amendment compelled Cuba to lease Guantanamo Bay to the U.S. Navy and to concede the right of the United States to intervene at will in Cuban affairs. When Cubans cried foul, they were told that adoption of the Platt Amendment into the new Cuban Constitution was the condition of U.S. withdrawal. The logic of Platt was undeniable. "There is, of course, little or no real independence left Cuba under the Platt Amendment," a triumphant Wood wrote the new U.S. President Theodore Roosevelt in October 1901. The more sensible Cubans realize this and feel that the only consistent thing now is to seek annexation. And that was not the end of it. 2 years later, these unequal partners signed a trade deal that ensured that Cuba would remain as economically dependent as it was politically subservient. The so-called Reciprocity Treaty of 1903 granted Cuba a 20% reduction in the U.S. sugar tariff in return for a still larger reduction in Cuban tariffs on a range of U.S. products. The treaty set off a sugar bonanza, increasing U.S. investment in Cuba from $80 million to $220 million in the decade after independence. By 1923, U.S. investment reached a staggering $1.3 billion, over half of it devoted to sugarcane production. The sugarcane industry employs its workers for at most 4 months a year, often as little as two. The rest of the year is called the tiempo muerto, or dead season, a term that speaks volumes to the ravages sugar has wrought on Cuban society. The trade agreement drained Cuba of capital that might have promoted new agricultural and industrial development, along with jobs and markets. A mixed economy might absorb laid-off workers. Cuba's sugar monoculture could not. By inflating the price of sugar, the Reciprocity Treaty triggered the conversion to cane fields of land formerly devoted to other agricultural commodities. Cuba struggles with the effect of these policies to this day. Strolling the streets of Havana in December 1899, Angel could be excused for missing Cuban simmering resentment. Having emerged from the war relatively unscathed, Havana bustled with businessmen, peddlers, immigrants, and hucksters of every shape and color, all vying for a piece of a country suddenly awash in U.S. capital. The North American presence was visible everywhere, from the steamships lined up outside the port of Havana, to the seawalls sprouting up across the city, to the work crews repairing bridges, dredging waterways, and laying rail. U.S. advertising dominated the front pages of the leading dailies, with McCormick Harvester, New York Trust, Iris Insurance, New York and Cuba Mail Steamship Authority, to name but a few, all promising to provide whatever anybody wanted faster, cheaper, better, and stronger than the competition, at very low interest and with minimal strings attached. Those tired of work could make their way to the New Cuba Theater, the proper place for American visitors to Havana, to fool away their time and spend their money, or catch Rigoletto or Aida at the Gran Teatro Tacon, the city's oldest playhouse. If Verdi was not your thing, you could cross the Prado to the still grander Teatro de Albizu with its full card of one-act comic operas. There was money for this, credit for that, cheap land here, ready labor there, even books promising to educate Cubans about the history and customs of their new benefactor to the north. Truly, a phoenix rose from the ashes of decrepit Spain. Those with initiative and daring might come along for the ride. Only the timid and tentative would be left behind. And yet resentment festered. Just the week before Angel's arrival, city papers reported a rally at the University of Havana, commemorating the murder of 8 Cuban medical students by Spanish soldiers in 1871. 50,000 habaneros joined the procession, including students, doctors, civil and municipal authorities, the city police, firemen, and various friendly corporations. Journalists described the crowd as restive and edgy. One speaker warned listeners not to lose sight of the nation's sacred and unequivocal commitment to independence or death, as if the struggle for Cuba Libre was not yet over. If Havana bustled, much of Cuba lay in ruin. The country lost an estimated 100,000 to 400,000 dead, depending on whether one counts non-combatants, as well as countless injured, maimed, and incapacitated by war, disease, and malnutrition. Private property suffered too, with some 100,000 small farms, 3,000 cattle ranches, 800 tobacco plantations, 700 coffee farms, and over 1,000 sugar mills completely destroyed. Terrible as it was, destruction created opportunity in a country with an acute labor shortage. The problem of labor on the island went back to the 16th century when Spain turned to Indians to work the mines. When the Indians succumbed to abuse and disease, Spain imported African slaves, continuing to do so until long after the slave trade became illegal in the Spanish Caribbean in 1820. Slavery was abolished in Cuba in 1886. The formal end of the slave trade compelled Spain to look to China for labor, which it did until the coolie trade itself was prohibited in 1875. With the Indians annihilated, slavery abolished, and Chinese importation banned, there was renewed demand for labor at the end of the war. This was especially true in rural areas, and above all in the East, where violence and whalers' reconcentration policy drove men and boys from the countryside. Part of the post-war negotiations between the United States and Spain, from which Gomez Garcia and their fellow Cubans were excluded, concerned the number of Spanish soldiers that would be permitted to remain in Cuba. Naturally, Cubans looked on Spaniards as competition. By contrast, U.S. investors viewed Spaniards as ideal workers. According to William Gerard Clark, author of a primer on business opportunities in post-war Cuba, Cubans, whether white, black, or medium-colored, eschewed wage labor, preferring to work their own plots despite competitive disadvantages. Years later, Cubans' commitment to private property would bedevil Fidel Castro's collectivization campaign. At the time of Angel's return to Cuba, it contributed to the underdevelopment of Oriente province, especially making the region ripe for Wood's economic modernization. The worker of choice from the planter's perspective was a former Spanish soldier, followed closely by Catalan and Galician immigrants. Where the former worked faithfully at any place or under any conditions, according to Clark, the latter distinguished themselves by their industry and other commendable qualities, all of which augured well for Angel Castro, until now the embodiment of the dispensable man. Angel did not remain long in Havana. After a few days exploring the capital and consulting fellow Galicians, he left for the town of Camajuani in Las Villas province, which Clark described as a small, unimportant station on the railroad line linking the region's north coast with its sugarcane fields. Angel did not linger there either, soon departing for Oriente province after a brief stop in Cayo Romano off Cuba's north-central coast. For a stranger in search of work, Oriente was a sensible destination. Nowhere did the milk and honey inundating Cuba flow more abundantly than there. Contemporaries spoke of the Americanization of Oriente province, historians of an invasion. By the early 1920s, this invasion made Oriente, long the least developed, least populated part of Cuba, the country's most densely populated province and second leading sugar producer. By 1929, foreign sugar growers, most of them American, had bought up 64% of the province. Three quarters of this investment was devoted to large-scale sugar production, which crowded out smaller coffee and tobacco enterprises, displacing Cuban farmers and replacing them with cheap Haitian, Jamaican, and other migrant labor. The transformation of Oriente was spurred by Civil Order No. 62, of the U.S. military government. Announced in March 1902, the order promoted the zoning and sale to American and other foreign investors of vast properties owned or occupied by small farmers. The small farms of the East had their origins in a system of communal landholding that developed in the 18th and 19th centuries on unoccupied royal estates. The Hacienda Comunera, as they were known, were divided into shares, pesos de posesión, representing the value of the original estate. To own a share of the value of the entire estate was not the same as possessing the title to a specific parcel of land, making property claims elastic. The informality functioned more or less effectively in a traditional setting. It became strained in the face of the American-led modernization, as the war destroyed public records and property titles, thus depriving small farmers proof of their proprietorship. In the end, farmers were left at the mercy of powerful forces bent on their demise. Legitimate owners of pesos de posesión were not the only ones who suffered. Oriente had long served as Cuba's safety valve. The teams of foreign developers that descended on Oriente after the war found much of the land occupied by squatters, some of whose families had been there for decades, even centuries, as well as by displaced veterans. Civil Order No. 62 ripped through this traditional landholding system like a locomotive tearing up Cuba's virgin forests, dispossessing legions of small farmers while disposing of their land for the scandalously low price of between $1 and $2 an acre. In short, conditions in Cuba were ripe for U.S. capital under the military occupation. U.S. capital arrived in abundance, unequaled before or since. Unhampered, Cuban scholars are quick to point out, by regulations in place in the United States. Oriente Province consists essentially of two great mountain chains, the fabled Sierra Maestra and the no less formidable Nipe-Sagua-Baracoa Massif. The mountains dominate the province's southern coast, north of which lies an extensive plain. These mountains, valleys, and plains endow Oriente with tremendous agricultural and mineral diversity, made accessible by miles of seacoast, navigable rivers, and generous bays. Elevations in the province range from sea level to over 6,000 feet atop the Sierra Maestra, thus supporting a variety of valuable timber, mahogany, mahagua, cedar, lignum vitae, lancewood and ebony, and agriculture, sugarcane, bananas, pineapple, tobacco, rice, and citrus. On the plains, cocoa, cafe, and indigo higher up. Blessed by rich alluvial soil, the mountains are ringed by grassy foothills suitable for large-scale ranching. The mountains are home to rich mineral deposits, including gold, copper, manganese, mercury, zinc, nickel, asphalt, coal, marble, alabaster, rock crystal, and precious gems, considerably adding to Oriente's commercial potential. After leaving Camajuani, Angel tried his luck in the mining town of Taquiri, east of Santiago, run by a subsidiary of Carnegie Steel. He found work as a night watchman, a job for which the war had left him overqualified. Carnegie paid the miners $1 per day. As a guard, Angel probably made a little more. A few dollars a day does not sound like much until you remember that land in North Oriente was going for just over $1 per acre at the time of Angel's arrival. There is scant evidence of his life among the miners. Many of them hailed from his native Galicia. He would have recognized the dialect and understood the references. There were few distractions in these mountains, and Angel seems to have succeeded in setting aside a small savings for the first time. He did not drink much, but he was a natural gamer with a memory for cards and the good sense to quit when he was ahead. For much of the year, Oriente is scorching hot and humid, even by Cuban standards. Miners lived in squalid quarters, not so different from those Angel had occupied as a soldier. It was not long before talk of cool breezes and greener pastures drew his attention to the rich, untapped country north of the Sierra Maestra in the vicinity of the Bay of Nipe. Collecting his few belongings, Angel departed the south coast, not knowing that his decades-long pilgrimage was nearly over. The Bay of Nipe sits atop the large shark tail that is southeast Cuba. Surrounding the bay on the north and west are fertile plains suitable for grazing and agriculture. To the south and west of the bay lies the Sierra Cristal, with its vast forests and mineral deposits. Up to the time of the U.S. occupation, the region was occupied by the sort of independent farmers whom Wood, Clark, and others regarded as an impediment to the region's economic development. In 1885, a man named Hippolyto Dumois, son of French emigres from Haiti, established a banana, citrus, and pineapple plantation just north of Nipe Bay, near the future town of Banes. In 1899, Dumois sold his land to Andrew Preston, owner of the Boston Fruit Company, who owned banana plantations across Latin America and would soon change its name to the United Fruit Company. In a few short years, Preston erected a new sugar mill called Boston, which spurred the transformation of Nipe Bay into one of Cuba's top sugar-producing regions. A few years after that, United Fruit purchased 200,000 more acres around the south coast of the bay, erecting yet another massive mill named Preston. The rise and consolidation of United Fruit Company in Cuba coincides with Angel's arrival in the region. His first stop in North Oriente seems to have been at or near the town of Mayari, not far from Preston. Mayari was a hub of the region's new development, and Angel would have collided there with labor drawn from all over Cuba and the Caribbean, as well as from China and the United States. American capital was on the march across the region, buying out small landholders, raising virgin forest, and converting a diverse agricultural base into sugarcane fields. This process entailed much dispossession and misery, as well as environmental degradation, but it also created jobs. New mills and mill towns needed constructing. Mills, warehouses, shipping ports, stores, factories, restaurants needed staffing and provisions. This labor force needed direction. Resilient, disciplined, and enterprising, Angel recognized in these necessities the chance of a lifetime. There are doubtless tremendous possibilities in store for those who will purchase and concentrate such properties, erect modern mills, and manage them according to the most improved methods, William Clark observed. There was also opportunity down the line, and it was there that Angel proved his usefulness as a medium between men looking for work and owners and managers in search of labor. As a former Spanish soldier and native of Galicia, Angel would have been given the benefit of the doubt in head-to-head competition for jobs, and he soon distinguished himself as a reliable foreman. Having worked for others all his life, he took his first step toward independence by purchasing a team of oxen, hiring himself out, then hiring other men to lead his team, before acquiring more oxen and still more men, and so on, until he commanded some 300 workers. With these teams of men and beast, Angel crisscrossed the Nipe region, draining swamps, cutting and burning forests, transporting timber, and planting and harvesting sugarcane. In an era of rampant speculation, nothing is more valuable than a contractor who can deliver the right men for the right job at the right time, and Angel soon amassed substantial savings. It is impossible to exaggerate the prosperity and progress in evidence in the Nipe Bay district, observed a leading trade magazine in 1905. That same year, Angel invested 200 pesos in a small inn located in the town of Guaro, down the road from Mayari, along the thoroughfare linking the United Fruit Enterprises at Boston and Preston. He named the inn El Progreso, an understated acknowledgement of his recent turn of fate. With its favorable location and ample shade, the inn provided much-needed respite from the blistering sun that scorched the east 9 months a year. The inn doubled as a country store, providing a burgeoning local population with cheese, olives, hazelnuts, honey, candy, sausages, flour, chestnuts, oil, wine, newspapers, and other sundries. 4 years later, on the verge of 35, Angel met the first woman to play a significant role in his life since the death of his mother. The woman's name was Maria Luisa Argota Reyes. Born in the port town of Jibara, 30 miles west of Banes, Maria Luisa grew up in Guaro under the supervision of her father, a manager at United Fruit. The couple married on March 25, 1911, and settled in Mayari, where Angel erected a spacious house on Avenida Leite Vidal. With decorative arches, high ceilings, paneled walls, and mosaic tile floors, this residence provided quite a contrast to the last place Angel had dared to call home. The willingness of Maria's father to allow Angel to marry his well-heeled daughter suggests the remarkable distance the illiterate peasant had come. For 5 years, Angel and Maria Luisa got along well enough, Maria liked the city life and hoped one day to trade Avenida Leyte Vidal for a home on one of the broad squares of Santiago de Cuba, the provincial capital, 100 kilometers to the south. The couple named their firstborn son Manuel after Angel's father, who died in 1903. Summoning the ghosts of Galicia proved inauspicious, and the boy did not make it to his first birthday. The next three children, two girls and a boy, survived. The fifth and final child, a daughter, did not, and the infant's death seems to have sunk a permanent wedge in the couple's relationship. Angel spent very little time at home. Running teams of men and oxen around the bay, managing his inn, training champion fighting cocks, he came to know and be known by owners, managers, administrators, and workers of the vast U.S. enterprises in the region, as well as by local Cuban businessmen and politicians. Greater and wider opportunities began to fall in his direction. In this way, he met an entrepreneur named Fidel Pino Santos, who was based in Santiago de Cuba, but who had business throughout the province, including with United Fruit. The men became friends, with Pino Santos playing the role of confidant and private banker, eventually becoming the namesake of a future president of Cuba. In 1915, Angel learned of a parcel of land for sale 30 miles south of Nipe Bay in prime cane-growing country. The World War was in its second year, and European beet production had ground to a halt, significantly elevating the price of Caribbean sugar. Meanwhile, the price of land throughout Oriente remained ridiculously low. With his modest savings and a 6% loan from Pino Santos, Angel purchased the 660-acre parcel known locally as Manacas for a little over $1 per acre. Located near the small town of Biran, the parcel became the foundation of Finca Manacas, the Castro family home. In succeeding years, Angel acquired 2,000 additional acres of his own while leasing another 22,000 acres from neighboring U.S. and Cuban planters. By the time he was done, his plantation comprised 42 square miles of some of eastern Cuba's richest farmland. Prosperity did not bring marital bliss to Angel and Maria Luisa. Maria Luisa never saw herself as a plantation mistress. Angel preferred the farm to the city. With the purchase of Finca Manacas, Angel came to spend more time at Biran than in Mayari, and the couple drifted apart. Lidia Castro, one of the couple's three surviving children, once asked her mother why she and Angel separated. "Live in the countryside?" Maria gasped. "No, thanks. The countryside is for birds and other animals." In 1920, Angel met the woman, the girl, really, who would become his soulmate. Lina Ruz Gonzalez made quite a contrast to Maria Luisa. Angel was 45, Lina was 17. Lina's family were sugarcane and tobacco farmers from Pinar del Rio in far western Cuba. Her family left home in 1910 after a cyclone destroyed their crops. They moved first to Camagüey, then to Oriente, where her father and uncle came to the attention of Angel. Being married, if separated from Maria Luisa, did not deter Angel from adopting Lina as a second wife, and the two began to produce a family of their own. They would have 7 children total, all of them born before Angel divorced Maria Luisa in 1941, and long before they themselves finally wed 2 years later. Angel and Maria Luisa's divorce seems to have been motivated by convenience rather than conviction, as he had to appear that day in court anyway to renounce his Spanish citizenship. Angel produced yet another child, Martin Castro, in 1930, with a local peasant named Generosa Mendoza, the informality of these relationships of little concern to him. The years immediately following the World War were difficult for Cuban planters. In May 1920, an extraordinary spike and vertiginous collapse of sugar prices, known colloquially as the Dance of Millions, imperiled the entire Cuban economy, causing banks to default while bankrupting U.S. and Cuban plantation owners alike. Angel managed to survive the crisis thanks to his constitutional restraint and to the generosity of his friend Pino Santos. Surveying the damage of the Dance of Millions, Angel recognized that the widespread bankruptcies left American lenders with more property than they could possibly take advantage of. He also knew from experience that the Americans could not run their Cuban enterprises single-handedly. Banks need borrowers. Farmers could not borrow if they did not stay afloat. As the frenzy of speculation came to a halt, Angel provided evidence of his farm's profitability, asking his U.S. lenders to freeze his loan payments for 3 years in exchange for a higher interest rate. The North Americans agreed. Pino Santos offered to back him, and Angel survived to farm another day. Angel Castro makes a curious subject of historical investigation. As the father of one of the 20th century's most controversial figures, Angel has many detractors. He has been accused of moving fences to increase his landholdings, a charge first made by a U.S. surveyor against the North American companies that surrounded his land. He has been described as domineering and abusive and labeled a philanderer. Such charges are difficult to deny or confirm. Amaury Troiano, a former acquaintance and a critic of Angel's son, who fought in the Cuban War of Independence, suggests Angel's faults have been exaggerated. His daughter, Juanita, insists that this has been the case. A childhood friend of Fidel, whose entire family worked for Angel in many different capacities, says that this was not Angel's reputation at the time. But for being the father of a future revolutionary, there is much in Angel's story for a U.S. audience to admire. He seems the very embodiment of Yankee ingenuity, the subject of one of the most improbable rags-to-riches tales of all time. He was a first-generation entrepreneur and capitalist who pulled himself up, borrowing money where he could find it, tapping political connections when needed, concentrating not on the hour-to-hour, day-to-day happiness of his family, as we shall see, but on how to ensure that his children never had to suffer the hardship he endured. In a one-way world in which U.S. politicians, bankers, and managers typically called the shots, Angel got along with his U.S. neighbors. The penniless laborer turned successful teamster become enterprising farmer did not regard the North Americans as adversaries. The North Americans, in turn, regarded him as somebody they could do business with. If less than warm, this relationship was civil and respectful, providing the Castro children a lesson in dignity and reciprocity that they would never forget. Chapter 2. Mornings on Horseback. A young boy lies awake in bed before sunrise, alert to the first stirrings of the family farm. Home for school vacation, he listens intently as the rustle of leaves and breathing of animals yields to the chirping of birds, cry of the rooster, and the howl of a dog, followed by footfalls and the murmur of his father, doling out the day's instructions to the farm manager. Accustomed now to the noise of the city, the boy never ceases to wonder at how quickly the pre-dawn quiet yields to the cacophony of an awakening barnyard. With big plans for the day, the boy does not dally. He rolls out of bed, pulls on a pair of worn trousers, a comfortable shirt, and sturdy shoes. He is going riding. Ever since he can remember, he has been comfortable on a horse. At age 6 or 7, his parents gave him a horse of his own named Careto, on which, with shotgun in hand, he explores the vast property. Sometimes he rides in the company of friends or siblings. Sometimes he rides alone. Today he is going solo. In recent years, his parents have granted him increasing leeway, asking few questions as he packs a lunch, saddles Careto, and heads off past the barns and outbuildings at the north end of the property before cutting east in the direction of the foothills, and ultimately, a favorite hideout named Pinares de Mayari, high atop the Sierra Cristal. He has promised to be home by nightfall. The Pinares de Mayari sits about 4.5 miles and 2,000 vertical feet above the heart of Finca Manacas. For the first mile or so, the going is easy, as horse and rider leave the fields that girdle the farm and mount the grassy foothills where his father grazes his cattle. On this part of the journey, the boy has few decisions to make, and Careto proceeds unguided. I loved that horse, the boy told an interviewer years later. Careto was smart and surly, restless, lively, and fast, and liked to escape his minders. In retrospect, horse and rider seemed a good fit. When Careto saw me coming, he would run away. I'd have to get one of the men to corral him. There is no well-worn route to Pinares de Mayari. The boy relies on a natural sense of direction to guide them. The going gets steep between miles 2 and 3 as the grassland yields to cedar, pine, caguairan, and mahogany forest. The boy eyes a shortcut which increases the risk as an errant step now could result in calamity. In summer days, the temperature down below can reach the 90s by mid-morning. Up here in the hills, it is considerably cooler. But even so, Careto's hide is spotted with sweat. After several hours, the ground levels and the pear emerge onto a mesa covered in red soil from local nickel deposits and topped by a thicket of pine. Alone with his horse, the boy gazes down on the plains below and experiences something close to bliss. He loves this place. There is always a cool breeze, and the trees provide relief from the blistering sun. There is also plentiful water from local streams, ice cold, pure, and delicious. The boy might stop there or proceed to lumber and mining camps deeper into the mountains, further evidence of his father's extensive enterprise, but he has already achieved what he came for. Up there in the woods and mountains, I experienced real freedom, he noted later. There was nobody telling me what to do. I traveled for miles and scaled mountains. The freedom and independence were but two of the incalculable gifts bestowed by a childhood at Finca Manacas. A mature Fidel Castro once told an interviewer that having grown up as the son rather than the grandson of a rich landowner, he was unafflicted by the sense of superiority that comes to those of aristocratic birth. The Castro farm straddled two worlds. The world of privilege that allowed a young boy to attend faraway schools and own his own horse, and the world of menial labor from which his parents delivered themselves and the source of his earliest friendships. The local children were his compañeros in everything, he said. We went to the river, the woods, and the fields together to hunt and to play. Jealous of his own freedom and aware of the inequality around him, Castro came to understand from an early age the arbitrariness of class and racial distinctions. Years later, while representing the down and out in his Havana law office or waging guerrilla war in the Sierra Maestra, Castro would be commended for the sympathy and sincerity he exhibited in conversation with peasants and common laborers. This too was a legacy of Finca Manacas, where he learned not to confuse social status or material possessions with merit. Castro entered the world on August 13, 1926, his birth supervised by an American physician from the United Fruit Company town of Preston, located on the eastern shore of the Bay of Nipe. In the decades before setting up shop in Biran, his father helped build Preston and clear the forests to make way for its cane fields. Angel remained on good terms with his former bosses, availing himself of their resources when necessary. This was his third child with Lina Ruz Gonzalez. He had lost two young children with his former wife. Wanting to take no chances with Lina's babies, he sent for the nearest doctor. The doctor arrived at Finca Manacas in the dry season, but the farm is located in such a way as to have access to water year-round while remaining functional in the drenching rains of May and October. Arriving on the scene a decade earlier, Angel found well-drained soil suitable for a farmhouse, barns, warehouses, shops, and other buildings. Its elevation above the surrounding fields left it open to the prevailing breeze, and the doctor may have noticed the large citrus grove at the north end of the property, situated to take advantage of the natural ventilation. With its back to the foothills of the Sierra Cristal, its front gazing out over the Holguin Plateau, the location of the Castro farm is spectacular. Those who like mountains will feel the tug. The Sierra Cristal is grand without being forbidding, providing solitude, relief from the heat, and a panoramic view of the neighborhood. But the mountains are more than inviting. They are suitable for grazing and home to rich timberland, as well as to valuable iron and nickel deposits. This is what prompted Angel to establish his farm there in the first place. Though devoted to sugarcane production, he would not leverage his family's fate on a fickle market. When sugar prices plummeted, he turned to other things, managing to keep afloat while many surrounding farms went under. In a region of Cuba dominated by foreign corporations and run by professional managers, Angel was unusual for being self-made, self-taught, and all but self-sufficient. He was more than a curiosity, but he was that too, and it was surely with bemusement and at least a little admiration that the doctor, spinning his wheel to the right, pulled into the lane of Finca Manacas and made for the farmhouse, where his patient Lina Ruz Gonzalez was in labor. Finca Manacas is said to have been an unusually clean farm, which sounds like a paradox to anyone who has tried to scratch a living from the earth. The cleanliness was not for want of real work going on there. Sugarcane, lumber, citrus, coffee, cocoa, bananas, mango, papaya, guava, passion fruit, potatoes, wheat, cabbage, carrots, beans, lettuce, tomatoes, and indigo were grown and harvested on the property. A dairy provided milk, cream, and cheese from cows, sheep, and goats. A bakery turned out fresh bread. An apiary produced fragrant honey. Owners, managers, clerks, and mechanics shared the grounds not only with the myriad neighbors who showed up to buy groceries, go to work, attend school, use the telegraph, mail a letter, have a drink, play ball, or see a cockfight, but also with horses, mules, cattle, pigs, sheep, goats, dogs, cats, chickens, guinea hens, carrier pigeons, parrots, turkeys, and champion fighting cocks. When it rains in eastern Cuba, it pours, turning roads into rivers, fields into lakes. And yet the Castro farm sparkled, so everybody says. Immediately to the doctor's left on entering the Castro farm lay a sparsely wooded field, scattered with thatched huts occupied year-round by Haitian workers. Many more Haitians arrived at the farm during the zafra, or sugarcane harvest, joining a collection of Cuban, Jamaican, and other West Indian migrants who wandered the island season after season looking for work. The Haitians who occupied these houpas were regulars. Some of them had families. The ones that did would come to know the Castro children, who showed up on a daily basis looking for playmates and occasionally the forbidden fruit of the aromatic maíz asado, roasted corn, which the children considered a delicacy, but which their mother believed would be the end of them. The countryside was freedom, Fidel Castro told an interviewer. Not for these Haitians. If welcome on the Castro farm, they were better off than their compatriots only by degree. Castro, the revolutionary leader, would come to adopt the Marxist critique that labor under capitalism is scarcely better than slavery. Slaveholders were at least responsible for ensuring the survival of their property, the argument goes. These Haitians migrated to eastern Cuba during the American-led sugarcane expansion that peaked during the First World War and the dance of millions. Many came without spouses or families, not expecting to stay. Some of the Haitian men shared a single woman in a local form of polyandry. This was not prostitution, Fidel Castro later insisted, just a practical response to an obvious problem. The Haitians were reliable workers. Angel paid them what his son considered a very low wage. No one gave much thought to Haitians' clothing, food, or health care, he said. They were abandoned to their luck. And this, on Angel Castro's farm, reputed to be the most forgiving in the region. Which gets us back to the farm's legendary cleanliness. This was not a product of the boss's fussiness, Pedro Pascal Rodriguez Rodriguez explains, but of his big heart, of his willingness to provide work that was not strictly necessary. Paquito Rodriguez is the youngest of 12 children from a peasant family that arrived in the region in the 1920s, after his father and older brothers were laid off by another plantation. They found work in Biran, where members of the family remain to this day. Born in 1925, a year before Castro, Rodriguez grew up alongside the Castro children, attending the primary school on the property and accompanying the Castro children at play. There are plenty of people in Cuba ready to tell a visitor what they think he or she wants to hear about the Cuban Revolution. Rodriguez passed a preliminary test of veracity when asked whether he knew that the young Castro was destined for the presidency of Cuba one day, answered effectively, "Hell no. He was a normal kid, like the rest of us, only a little different." Asked to explain that difference, Rodriguez said that the first thing people needed to know about Castro's life was that Biran Castro, as locals knew the place, was no ordinary farm. Angel was no ordinary owner. An answer that presupposes a little historical background about early 20th century Cuba. In the decade of Castro's birth, Cuba continued to struggle with the economic and political distortions introduced by the Platt Amendment, the Reciprocity Treaty, and prioritization of U.S. over Cuban interests at the time of the early republic. The U.S.-funded recapitalization of the island's sugar industry created insurmountable barriers to entry for farmers shy of capital, effectively shutting out the middle class while creating a demand for cheap labor. With sugar production dominated by foreigners and lacking an industrial base, Cuban professionals turned to politics as a way to make a living. As a result, the government became an instrument not for solving the nation's problems, but for distributing political spoils. By the mid-1920s, Cuba's federal bureaucracy and payroll swelled to unimaginable levels as the island became a welfare state for displaced elites, channeling the island's resources into the pockets of professional politicians. These political and economic distortions were embodied in the person of Gerardo Machado, elected president in 1924 on a platform of public works, anti-corruption, and political and economic independence, but who quickly revealed himself to be a shameless, even sadistic, power monger. Combined with U.S.-funded public works projects, Machado's bullying might have kept a lid on Cuba, but 1926 marked the beginning of a protracted slide in Cuban sugar prices that would grip the country for the better part of a decade. As sugar goes, so does Cuba. The falling prices reverberated up and down the nation's economy, with planters laying off workers and the federal government suspending the salaries of school teachers and other public servants, just as protests erupted across the country. Machado's response to the protests was clumsy and self-serving. With a pliant Congress executing his will, Machado jiggered Cuban election law to give himself the potential to remain in office through the mid-1930s, while outlawing public demonstrations and suspending constitutional guarantees. "Make political opposition illegal," former President Carlos Mendieta warned at the time, "and all you have left is violence." Violence ensued. In May 1930, Machado's police stormed an opposition meeting attended by the war hero Juan Gualberto Gomez, killing 8 and wounding dozens. In September, the university erupted with a student named Rafael Trejo, killed by police. Inevitably, Machado's heavy-handedness provoked further violence. Statues of Machado and other political leaders were torn down. Protesters and police exchanged gunfire. The ranks of martyrs swelled. By the end of the year, schools across the island were shuttered, and the army patrolled the streets. Machado hung on for another 3 years, unleashing his police and military, along with a gang of private thugs known as the Porra, on opponents left, right, and center. The opponents responded in kind as the country descended into armed conflict. Always wary of unrest in Cuba, the United States government dispatched a special ambassador to Havana in May 1933 in the hope of establishing a truce and finding a replacement for Machado. Amid escalating violence and with the United States pulling the strings, Machado was replaced in mid-August by Carlos Manuel de Céspedes, son of the War of Independence hero of the same name. Unable to restore peace and lacking legitimacy, Céspedes was deposed by a military coup known as the Sergeants' Revolt on the evening of September 4, 1933. As if surprised to find themselves in power, the sergeants formed an unlikely alliance with a group of leftists led by Antonio Quiteras and moderates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.